back to the pitch. It is Sarah and Manny, and we're here. All you Red Sox people know him as El Guapo. Welcome to our show.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Thank you, Howard, for having me on the show. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Yeah, we love having you. What are you even up to during this quarantine? This is kind of sucky, huh?
Well, you know. Technical
difficulties.
Around here it's really difficult, you know. It just it's been raining. You know, weather. I'm here in Connecticut right now, so I'm like an hour from New York and an hour and a half from Boston. So much in the middle, you know, those two big cities. So it's kind of hard to internet to communicate. Even I call back home. It's kind of difficult to connect to. So everything is fine. Everything's fine. The only thing is, you know, I've been like everybody else, quarantine. You know, here in my house and looking for my girls. They're going to a school for internet, so they're gonna. My older girl is gonna have. Is gonna go to high school right now, so she's gonna graduate to through the internet. So it's kind of pitch a little bit. You know what? Right. You know whatever things happen right now is like crazy. You know with this pandemic, but you know everything is fine. Thank you very much. Thanks.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, for Manny's a good math teacher.
Yeah, I know. Now that my kids don't have any school, I became a teacher overnight. So it's, you know, but I agree with you, Guapo. It's not easy, but it's you know, we got to do what we got to do. Try to stay safe and keep the kids busy, as we say. But teaching my kids right now is like pulling teeth. You know, it's tough, man.
I'm trying to do whatever I can to help them out, but you know, it's like All those things that you see when you used to be in a school, you know, it's a long way away from me. So it's not the same that you used to do with right now. Now it's totally different to the computer, you know, for the internet, and they do, you know, school thing on the internet. So they know a lot about internet. Not even me. I'm 50 years old. I don't even know nothing about internet. So they know pretty much everything about it. So they know. That whole all the way around. Yeah, good. Yep.
Yeah. Well, my most important question is playing for the Red Sox, what was it like for you two together and all that stuff?
well, I mean, I've been answering the same questions to the old guys that I'm doing it in Spanish too. So it's like, hey dude, why don't you make a book or something? Because your story is like a long, long, long story. So it's like, you know, it takes a lot of time. Look at Luis Young. He's making a book, and it took a lot of years to make those book. To Luis Young, he's been showed to the people. And, you know, but, you know, Boston is like my home. Boston, the fans. Yeah. You know, I never had that excitement when I was pitching out there. Even like a year ago, I went to throw the first pitch, and I don't know, you know, I got a goosebump, you know, people just, you know, cheering and having me on the field throwing the ceremonial first pitch was something unbelievable, great feeling. It's like I went back to my house, you know, the teammates, the whole organization. You know, I never played with Manny before, but through the years, he was with me in the independent ball, throwing a little bit that year here with me, and really happy to have him in the team, and I know Manny from there, and then we're going to go fantasy camp the same way, so it's exciting to go back to Boston to see, and I've been signing a lot of autographs and baseball cards for a lot of fans in Boston, and they're really happy to see me back again, and to see me the way that I'm doing right now. But I'm really, it's exciting to go back to Boston. And every time when I go watch some games, they always invite me to do it. And it's like really my pressure to go back and visit the fans. And they always worry and ask me a lot of questions. Where are you? What are you doing right now? It's like I'm really excited to hear a lot of fans asking me where I'm doing everything. But everything is fine. Good. Every time when I go back out there, it's like a dream come true again. So very happy.
Yeah, Sarah. I don't know if I told you, but Rich was my second to last pitching coach I played in independent ball for the Bridgeport Bluefish in Connecticut. Yeah,
it was my that's so funny.
So when I saw him, I was like, oh, this is going to be – we had a really fun year. It was awesome. And
yeah.
I mean, hey, Guapo, another thing, like what are your thoughts on what the MLB is doing right now with the proposal of, you know, like shortening the season and all the money? Like what are your thoughts on what's going on and what do you think they should actually do if they have a season?
Well, what I think is I've been reading a lot of, and you know, Tony Clark is used to be my teammate when I was with Boston, and you know, I've been seeing a lot of, you know, opinions with people and all the things they got to take care of to do that, and it's gonna be hard for everybody. You know, short season, you know, you're not gonna be 100% ready to go. I mean, they have to do is sit down, talk about it, and you know, come in an agreement and see if they can, you know, I don't think it's kind of going to happen. I don't know if they have to, you know, go back and only for three, four months.
I've been telling Sarah it's a combination of things, because I know as players, we work so hard
to get to the
big leagues. Now, you're saying cut the season in half, which I understand. You know, the fans, I miss baseball too. I miss watching it. So, but at the same time, you want to be safe. So now you're telling these players to take a pay cut, play less of a season, and no fans. And I told Sarah and people, I'm like, when you get out of an inning and you strike somebody out with the bases loaded, like that impact that the Red Sox Nation has on you at Fenway Park is indescribable. So you need that. You know,
you need definitely you need the fans though. That's the more important thing. You need the fans out there.
Yeah. So right now they're saying no fans. So it'll be exciting to see what they do.
I want to see that when that happens. So I want to be there when that happens, because I don't know what they're gonna do though. It's gonna be hard. It's gonna be hard to see baseball like this. You know, it's gonna be hard all around. So let's see what happens, and we wait and see what was gonna happen. But I don't see baseball without a fan out there. So
I think that would be weird. I even saw, like, they were talking about how they didn't want them, you know, doing chewing tobacco or like eating the sunflower seeds. And that's
no high five.
Oh yeah.
How do you hit a home run and strike out the bases loaded and we can't high five? You know,
Guapo,
good job, man.
You can even go. I don't know what the manager and coach is gonna do. If you have to take the lineup to the umpires, to the home plate, you got to get the meeting in there. It's not allowed to do that, you guys.
They're gonna send it through a laptop. Like they look at probably. Each other, press enter. You know?
Oh, now they're gonna use an iPad. So iPad iPhone or whatever to send a message to the umpires.
Another thing that the 67-page book that they sent the players and everybody, like. They're talking about, like, the pitcher starts with the ball. If the hitter hits the ball to the shortstop and they turn a double play, they got to throw the ball out. They're going to use, like, 1,000 baseballs for one game.
Exactly. That's another thing I don't understand. Yeah.
It's a lot of stuff, but, I mean, you as a player, I mean, I play, like, I love the fans. I love being able to get that atmosphere, and it's going to be tough. For me, I don't really see it happening, but I'm trying to be optimistic about it. Like, I want it to come back. But I'd rather be safe than sorry, you know. I'd rather everybody.
Exactly. I mean, it's a group of guys that's saying that they don't really want to continue for this year. I mean, 2020, they'll probably be delayed for next year, maybe. But some of the guys who just want to be, just like everybody said, they want to be safe, you know. Yeah. And that's, I agree with it, and I agree with you too. So I don't know what's going to happen, but I want to see that when the guys hit a home run and you can high five.
Like another example I tell people is, you know, example, Mookie Betts just got traded to the Dodgers.
Yeah.
You know, $27 million with the Red Sox, not getting paid right now. And you're telling me that they're going to go this year without playing and he's going to be a free agent now?
That would be weird.
Do you know what I mean? It's – A lot of guys that
it's like unbelievable.
Players that came back, players that are on comebacks in their careers, like had a really good year last year to make an impact, And now this year they don't play. Like, what happens to those guys next year? Yeah. What happens to guys like ready for that contract year after this year? Yeah. And they got to wait another year now. So it's
yeah.
a lot of stuff. Man.
Yeah, it's a lot of it's a lot of little things and a lot of issues going through that right now. But it's like you say, you know, I agree with you the same way. You know what's gonna happen? We never know what's gonna happen. So let's wait and see what's coming, and we get into it and we talk about it. But right now, I don't know what the, I really usually like to say. We don't know yet, so.
Yeah, I just think it would be weird, you know, while you guys are playing that I can't sit on the sidelines and have a hot dog and a beer. I mean, what would life be in the summer?
You cannot miss a traditional beer and a hot dog in the stands. That's the bottom line. That's a traditional, you know, fans. Yeah, that's what it is. I mean, it's like you have a baseball game. There's nobody out there in the field. They're doing it right now in Korea. That's what it is. They're doing it right now out there. But you see, they got posters in the stands with the supposed to be a people, and nobody is in the stadium. So you know if you see that in there, you know what's coming here in the States with the Major League Baseball. So you know it's.
I mean, I think they're going to try to do something, but at the same time, you know, with all the rules, with all the trying to stay clean, they're telling the players that after, let's say John Lester just finished pitching and he has to go inside and get his treatment. They're saying no treatment, no showers, no cold tub, no nothing. So how are you supposed to, as a reliever, how are you supposed to go pitch the next day? You know, it's just crazy. So
I don't know. When that happens, just let me know, Manny.
I know. No, you let me know. Cause
It's not coming. But I don't know.
I think Sarah knows before we do.
Yeah, probably. Yeah. She probably likely. Knows.
I know everything.
I know you do.
She thinks she knows everything, but
That was really good. I mean, we don't know. We don't know what's going to happen, but, you know, we just – I wanna see when that happens, because it's gonna be interesting to see that reaction of people with no fans in the games and only players, and you cannot have any high fives, and you can have no chewing tobacco, you cannot have anybody's talking to an umpire, so everybody's wearing a mask. So it's kind of interesting. I want to see that. So what do you think?
And the thing is, and it's not only with baseball too. It's hockey, basketball. Like, they're trying to figure out
everywhere
to come back as well.
Yeah,
but it's I tell people like the Celtics were playing really well, the Bruins were playing really well, and now starting the season up like that, it's kind of like, what if they're not the same team? Like, they don't click as well. And now you're gonna blame it all. Now you're gonna blame it on this pandemic that happened. You know, so they really got to think about the players when it comes. Baseball, obviously, didn't start. They were in spring training still, so they can still get ready for it. But, like, basketball is starting up in, like, 2 weeks. It's going to be different. It's going to affect a lot of people.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm a huge Celtics fan, as everybody knows. And those boys, they have to jive again. They haven't played together for, what, almost 3 months now? They're going to have to call the season and just – it is what it is.
That's what I'm trying to say. I mean, if my personal opinion is, you know, just call it out. And then we see you guys the next year, and we starting fresh, because now they're talking about be safe, and that's one of the reasons you got to be safe. You don't want to contaminate it. You don't want to especially myself. And I'm working at an academy that I cannot really go into the academy because I got like a diabetes type 2, so that I cannot go out there. But if I can get contaminated, and I'm going to be very sick, so. You know, think about it. You know, it's a lot of people in the middle of everything. So, you like you say, you know, I agree with you. You should be calling it off. And they're going to start fresh. Everybody's ready for this. That's it. Personal opinion.
I love sitting there. We've been sitting with the same people for 15 years. I don't even get to see them anymore. The playoffs is the high of the season. That's why you buy some tickets.
Yeah, exactly. Yep.
Guapo, but besides the sports, because we could talk about this pandemic and this virus, like, what else have you been doing with the kids, the wife, to stay busy? Because I ran out of stuff to do, man. Like, I ain't got...
I cannot really tell you that much. The only thing that I really do, I've been doing, we just go to a grocery store for like for one day every 2 weeks and do buy some groceries and, you know, but pretty much we cannot, we don't have no chance to get out of the house. We live in an apartment. So the only thing that I've been doing is jumping in a treadmill and, you know, walk it off for like an hour and a half of working pretty much every day.
You're getting ready for fantasy camp.
Yeah, I'm just trying to be ready. We cannot let you go another three more games, four more games. So we're gonna hook you up.
20 innings, man. My arm still hurts from this.
Wow, break. Unbelievable. You got it going on, man. That was awesome that time. You pitched like five games. Unbelievable.
Yeah, I felt it for the next two months.
I know. I heard you. I've been there too, so it's kind of hard. But anything else, I mean, the clubhouse, the academy that I work for, they're closed. They've been closed for the last three months. What we're doing here, we just the girls, we not get out of the house for like 2.5 months, so. Yeah. Sometimes yeah. I'm kind of scared because I don't want them to, hey, Dad, I want to go. But, you know, what can I do, man? I cannot do nothing about it. I want to keep him safe, protect for everything, and you know, and one day at a time. We can do nothing about it. And,
sorry,
Manny. Go ahead.
No, you're good. Go ahead.
My friend just said they opened etiquette yesterday. I went to UConn, so I have a lot of good friends out there. She's a freak. Because, you know, she's got young children, and she's asking me, should they be wearing masks while they're out? She goes, a lot of people are just out and about without a mask. It's interesting to see what happens. Like, in 10 days, if all these people get sick. I mean, yeah, it's not gone.
Exactly. And I've been hearing a lot of politicians are talking about, you know, hey, let's reopen everything, but... you know, right now, if you open everything, probably we're going to have like a setback. Mm-hmm. Because what happened, we're going to have a setback because everybody think, hey, no, everything is cool. You know, we got like 85 degrees, 90 degrees. Nothing is going to happen. No, it's going to happen. Mm-hmm. Because you got to wear a mask. You got to wear your gloves. You got to go outside. You're going to go past the people close. You cannot, you know, it's like, it's not separation between people and... You go to the store, you pass by people every time. I mean, what secure is that? You know, you're going to have it. So that's the only thing that I really do. I just put my mask with my wife and I take the rubber gloves and we go into the grocery store and we do what we have to do. But we have to protect ourselves. But I don't think it should not start anything into that pandemic thing. It's pretty much we have a vaccine for it, and that disappeared for.
I want life to go back to normal.
Me
but at the
too.
Same time,
me
like,
too.
Talking to Sarah, it's you know to have an economy, you need people, and if people are still dying from this, like eventually we're gonna get wiped out because we're trying to force the issue of getting the economy back when we need people to make it run. But it's you know it's. It's tough, man.
They worry about so much about the economy, but they don't worry about people.
No,
and that's the thing that we have to worry about. It, you know, about people. People has to be taken care of first, and then if we can now open the economy again, you know what can we do? You know, we can do nothing about it. You can get sick. There's a lot of people dying. You know.
I know.
And it's scary. It scares me. You know. Even in my country, in the same way. Yeah,
but like you say, you have diabetes. I'm an asthmatic. Yeah. So that one person could ruin our lives. Just that one person.
Period.
Not, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You don't know what it's going to be. So.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people don't know they have it, right, Manny? Not that
you know. We don't know. I don't know.
No, it's true. It's very true.
I'm not saying he has it.
But Guapo, another to switch it and make it funny again. Like, how did you get the name El Guapo? Like, I know it was something that you just woke up and somebody said, "Oh, that's gonna be a nickname for your career."
I tell you, I got to Boston, and I got to Boston in 96, spin training. I met a lot of guys, like Mike Maddox is Greg Maddox's brother. He was there with me. Stan Belinda. My manager that year was Kennedy. He was my manager. He used to be the manager for the Texas Rangers. And then they got me a chance to make the team for the spring training. And they asked me, hey, Guapo, Garces, you think you can make it? Hey, just give me a chance. Give me a ball. I just want to go out there and do my job. That's it. That's the thing. I worry about it. So I went out there in the spring training, and I did my job. I did my job, and I made the team in the spring training. When I got to the season, I was doing my job, like supposed to do my job, and situations that I don't even realize that I was get out of the situation. And then with one pitch that I threw, bases loaded, one out, double play, and I was get out of the inning so easy. Like everybody was like, Guapo, how do you do that? He said, dude, I don't know. I just throw one pitch. And that's what happened. I don't know what to tell you. That's what happened. Yeah, exactly. I don't know. I just threw one pitch in the right situation with the right batter, and here we go, ground ball double play. What can I say? You know, but I always have fun with baseball, and even when I was with Boston. And the guy talked to me a couple of times was Mike Maddox. Mike Maddox told me a couple of times, dude, you so nice, man. Yeah, you had a lot of fun. You smile every time. People like you. People say hello to you every time. We say, hey, dude, you know, got a little affection with people. So, you know, especially Boston fans, you know. And then before you know, he just, hey, dude, we got to find you a nickname. No matter what happened, we got to find you a nickname. And I was like, what kind of nickname? He said, no, we cannot call you at a big guy or fat guy or whatever it is or whatever. I always say, yeah, we have to call you. We have to look for a nickname. And you don't mind, did you? Yeah, no, man, no problem, man. If you like to put one, that's fine. It's fine. I just want to have some fun. And I want to keep dreaming to be in the big leagues, especially with Boston, especially there's a tradition between Boston and the Yankees, a rivalry all the time between those two teams. So I was kind of excited too. And then one time, the game is over. I was in that game in a 7 situation. I get out of the situation. So as soon as the game is over, I was like, hey, dude, I'm going to looking for that nickname. Telling you. Just remember, so when I call you late, it's because it's going to be me. I would say, okay, that's fine, man. Don't worry about it. I'm going to go to sleep. So I left about 1 o'clock. So I was already in bed, and I received a phone call from Mike Maddox. And he was like, dude, you know who's calling you? Yeah, I know who's calling. Dude, I just went back them to back, man. What's going on? We say, hey, dude, I find your nickname. You don't mind if you go to the ballpark tomorrow at 11:30 so we can get the meeting going on out there in the clubhouse? Say, okay, that's fine. Whatever you say, Papi. But the next time, don't call me at 2 o'clock in the morning, please. Thank you, man. Yeah. So we went to the next day. We went to the clubhouse. He's got the big meeting. We got the, like a scoreboard in one of the walls out there in the clubhouse. He's got a cover with towel and tape. And everybody was like asking themselves, hey, dude, what are we doing here? We say, hey, we got a meeting. Mike Maddox got a meeting for everybody. So Kennedy come out from the office. He was like, hey, what's going on? We said, oh, Mike Maddox has a meeting over here. So he wants everybody in the room and everything. And he's going to have something, you know, something for Garces over there. And then that's what the Guapo started from there. He just keep those towers down, and then that's what it says, El Guapo. And then he bought that movie. They call him The Three Amigos.
Yeah.
I think one of the guys in the movie was Chevy Chase. And right away, he told me, dude, this is the movie. Check the movie, and you're going to find out where's the nickname has come from. So that's what they call it, The Three Amigos, the movie.
No, so, I remember The Three Amigos. It was
the
head honcho, El Guapo.
El Guapo was a bad guy. El Guapo was a bad guy. So I was like, dude, okay, some bad guy. No, man. You're the brave guy, man. You awesome. You, yeah, that's your nickname from now on.
In the movie, he wasn't scared of nothing. He just didn't care. So that's the reason why.
Exactly. And there, some
on the
people.
On the mound.
Some, Yeah, exactly. Exactly. It's some fans. It's like, hey, the handsome one, the handsome one. No, 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 no. You got the wrong puppy. I'm not the handsome one.
I'm not the handsome one.
I'm not the handsome one. I'm not the handsome one, but you know that's it. That's the way I do my job in the field. You know, give me the ball, go out there in the mound, do my job, and here we go. Thank you very much. That's it. That's a, yeah, exactly. And then from 96 and on, it was like everybody was like, they don't even call me Garces or Rich. Everybody was like Guapo, and everybody was Guapo.
Even till today, I hug you and I call you Guapo. Like, what's up, Guapo? You know?
Yeah, exactly. No, everybody. It's like the pandemic in those times, you know, from 96 to all the way to 2002, it was like crazy about that nickname and Guapo. And also, you know, I enjoyed it every single minute, every single time that I was in Boston. Things that unbelievable. That's like I say, that's my family. And I always, when I go back to Boston, I always remind me all those good things that happened in that field and clubhouse. And every time when I see Manny, it's like I remember a lot of those things. And those are good times that you guys enjoying and winning the World Series. And, you know, I always hope them, and, you know, I would probably be in one of those World Series. But you know what? You know,
deep down, we all want them together. Everybody,
exactly. No doubt.
We all want it together.
Yeah, exactly. And another thing is the only thing that I really want before I signed professional was my dream come true is to be on the big leagues with one of the good teams, and that's what happened. My dream was true. I mean, it went through. So. You know, I cannot say nothing else to really, but like you say, if we want everybody. Yep. Everybody who in there for together. So, you know, that's what the Guapo stars.
Yeah. Especially what the organization does, like having guys like yourself, like Pedro Martinez, like I've seen Mike Timlin, Keith Folk, like you guys still come back and help the next generation of players coming up to win more championships. So
exactly.
From here on out,
exactly.
Any other championships, we also feel like we, you know,
well, yeah,
with the organization and we're together, you know.
But you know something, when I left in 2002, dude, you know who was crying a lot in 2004? This guy right here, crying like a little kid.
Oh, dude, I know.
But now, not for being sad, just be so happy to see a team that I played for 7-8 years winning the World Series, man. That was like great feeling, happy for every single guy contribute to that World Series. And I still met him with the guys. Even you, when you in the World Series, I think it was 2013, I think?
Seven.
Even you guys, when you guys won in 2007, I was like, you're crying, dude. It's feeling like I'm there too, man.
Yeah. And that's the thing, awesome. Like I tell people, I go to Fenway and like you just get that, like even as an analyst now, like I get to go to the games and I'm just like, man, like it's a special place, and it definitely brings back a lot of memories.
No doubt, my friend.
Did you fall asleep over there?
Don't hear.
Oh, they fell asleep.
No, I have a story about 2004. Now my dad always been a huge Yankees fan. So it was so much fun us being Red Sox fans, and he loved the Yankees. Jeter, him and my grandfather would be on the phone talking about them, like, man, Steve Rodriguez, he sucks. And then in 04, I will never forget this. I the whole world's excited. I get home. He is in the worst mood ever. And I'm like, oh my God, did you see me? He took his bedroom door, slammed it in my face. He did not, Dad, you didn't speak to me, because I know he'll be watching this, for 3 days.
Wow. He took to very serious.
Yeah, he is very serious. God. He's not as into them as he was. But, I mean, those were like, you know, 96. Throughout were like huge, like, years of the Yankees-Red Sox rivalry. And it's not really there as much yet as, but those were the times.
I got you.
Watching it as a fan, I was at UConn for most of that. Everybody liked the Yankees.
Yeah, awesome.
Not everybody's perfect, you know.
No, they're not.
Not exactly.
Sorry, you're not perfect. Sorry.
That was awesome. That was good, man. I mean, for you, just, you know, that Yankee Boston is like, wow. You always had to, when we're talking about the scouting board or the book we have to read to be all this guy, the report about the every single hitter and every single player and the Yankee lineup, it's like a headache all the time. They give you a headache because the book is about this big. I don't know if Manny can tell you.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
About this big. And every single batter, every single player on the team, and every different account, you know, whatever, dude, it's like, oh, my God, here comes the Yankees. But you know something? Every time when the Yankees come to Fenway Park, I was like, ooh, we're very, very excited. Very excited because the people, they put a little jalapeno to the thing, you know?
Yeah.
Little
always.
Spice. And a little awesome. Spicy to
well, the thing is, Sarah, every single game is like, you know, obviously the rivalry, the Yankees, wow, Red Sox. Yeah. When are they going to fight? So it was always like playoff atmosphere. So you're having playoff games literally like in May just because of the Red Sox Yankees, you know? So it was definitely exciting, and you can feel it too. Like, you know, just what's going to happen? Like, who's going to fight? Like, what are we going to fight, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Always.
And the same thing, and the same thing in the Bronx as well. So.
Yeah. Yeah. It's always something.
Yeah.
Son of Yankees, always something.
Yeah.
It's like you wait for something happens. People just, you know, somebody throw one and right here in the head. It's like, okay, here we go. You know, just waiting for something to happen. But
I remember going out to the bullpen at Old Yankee Stadium, and it got so packed so fast. Like, they opened the doors early for the fans, and like four guys like overlooking the bullpen, just they lifted their shirts and they had a shirt that says something really inappropriate to the bullpen, and they got kicked out before the game even started. I'm like, why would you do that? At least wait till like the sixth inning and then do it, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
But it's,
exactly.
You know,
they're always gonna.
The you know, the fans is what makes the game. So, like I said, we talked about it, and it's gonna be tough not to be able to see that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, yeah. I mean, you're in the bullpen as a relief pitcher. You know, you have to, it's gonna happen to you. It doesn't matter because, I heard a lot of bad things about me in the bullpen, and even in the Yankee Stadium. And the one thing you cannot have is any argument with nobody, especially with the fans. I mean, you know, they, you know, the one thing I not agree with is, you know, they pay to see us to play at that and the field and everything. But one thing you got to do is you got to respect. You know, as long as you respect.
And you know, it's all. I got hot dogs thrown at us in Cleveland. Hot dogs. And I'm like, at least throw the buns down too so I can eat them. You know? I'm like, where's the buns at so I can eat it? But, you know, it's true. You know, they do have the respect, and some of them don't, and it's kind of tough.
Yeah, exactly. Because as soon as I went on, they had one of those core, and they, you know, like a nachos box?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He said wine right to me. I was just throwing that, and I met up in the book, and the nacho box was right in front of my face. I was like, hey, call the security guy. He took, hey, Guapo, no, it's okay, man. I'm going to give you a nacho so you can have more power. It's okay. I was like, okay. You know, at least I was not something inappropriate, you know. It was just something funny. And I take that. I don't care. You know, I'm fine as long as, you know. But some fans say they just, you know, they got to give a little respect to the players. And because it's not easy.
So what else you got for Mr. Guapo? Because I feel like we've been talking for like 3 hours and my back hurts.
what you got for me? Ask any question. Don't worry.
I know. Guapo's like, Grandpa's like, I ain't going nowhere. I'm stuck at home, man.
I gotta start
making dinner, man. All right.
Well, you know what? In a couple months, we're gonna come back and we're gonna revisit this conversation to see. Let's see if baseball does start. It'll be interesting, and if it does, and what kind of way? You know?
No, it is. We're talking about it. I don't know what's gonna happen, but it's gonna be interesting.
It will be interesting.
It will be interesting. I wanna see it and see if it works or not.
Once we get more word on everything, we're gonna call you back, put you back on the show, and see what you really think. If it does happen, if it's too early, if players should agree or not agree, but we'll wait a little bit longer and then we'll get you back on the show.
Yes. Hey, no problem, my friend. Thank you very much for having me on the show, Papi.
For spending
I appreciate it. You too. Thank you very much, Sara. I appreciate it for having me here. Thank you.
All right.
Gracias, Guapo.
Yeah, gracias. Tranquilo, Papi. Me too, Papi. Estamos hablando. Yep. Dale. Bye. Dale.
All right. We'll see you guys next week on the pitch. Have a good night.
You too.
Bye.
Bye.